Let's talk about using data for accurate decision-making. Hey, this is Justin Hitt with Inside Strategic Relations. We are surrounded by data today. The COVID virus is they're talking about countries with numbers of deaths. They're talking about the number of people who are infected and the decisions about how we're going to maintain quarantine or not, whether stores are open or not, is being made based on data. Now, they're receiving data from a number of sources. They're receiving data from actual test measurements of individuals. They're receiving data from sampling. So, for example, if you've wondered why they left people on cruise ships when there's a viral outbreak, is because that provides a petri dish in which they can measure and accurately see the spread of the disease because no individuals will be introduced or removed from that environment. And it's not some sick science experiment. In fact, those individuals may be safest on the ship isolated from shore because when you have a viral outbreak, it's also on shore as well. But long story short, it gives them some accurate measures in order to determine, is the viral outbreak happening consistently between different places? Now, here's what's important. The number of deaths don't matter. See, a lot of businesses, when they create dashboards or they create metrics, they're measuring counts. And that's because that's what we tend to measure. We count the number of dollars we have. We count the number of years we've aged. But that is just simply a calculation or a simple measure, not a contextual measure that provides us any information necessary to make decisions. So a more accurate measure of the coronavirus spread is actually the number of individuals infected per thousand, or the number of cases per thousand, or the number of deaths per thousand. It actually matters more how many people in a population with the context of demographics, the context of pre-existing condition, the context of density, population density. All those measures together will give you an accurate fight or flight response to a viral outbreak. Now, I'm not the CDC, nor do I play the CDC on television, but I do risk metrics for Fortune 100 organizations, and I provide clients other metrics around business development and sales. And in both of those environments, you have to make a decision about where to apply capital, where to apply money. Where is the best place to put money so that our computer systems stay up and running during a natural disaster? Where should we put resources and people so that we are compliant with different federal or state regulations? Where should we put people to make sure the processes in which we use to reduce risk are actually being implemented as designed rather than as convenient for the individuals involved with it? Those are the types of places where measures are more practical and where likely as a high-income professional entrepreneur, you'll see these measures every day. One such example we provide in an article we did a few years ago was about customer lifetime value. So how much is a customer worth over its first 12 months with your business? How much is a customer worth after 5 years? Those are two different measures of the same underlying data that make that data more useful. If you bring on 100 customers this year and you know that each customer will be worth net $1,000, that tells you something. Even if the individual transactions of those customers is above or below that number. We're now taking a composite, so we're taking the number of customers that come on board. We're taking the value per each customer, both gross and net. So we're determining what is the profitability per each customer. If you're a contractor, you might do that on a per project basis. If you're selling products in a catalog, you might do that on a gross transaction or a individual product basis. You're going to add in your marketing costs. You're going to add in your contributed overhead costs. And you're going to come up with some value per customer. And then that is going to then translate into a value over a period of time based on other historic transactions. And finally, give you some number you can work with. Unfortunately, I don't mean to break it to you like this. Even if you do have the customer lifetime value over a 12-month period for all of your customers and the customer lifetime value over a 5-year period for all your customers, you still don't know what composition of customer. Is it the customer who buys quickly that becomes the most valuable over time? Is it the customer who has a large business who is most valuable over time? Or is it a customer that is buys a certain type of product first who's more valuable? Now, the reason data can get so complex and so confusing is because there's a lot of it. What you want to avoid is falling back to the rabbit hole where you're digging down data and then things get all blurry and your eyes, you get all confused. And next thing you know, you're reading tea leaves. You're simply looking at the data and then getting a feeling about it. You know, I got a good feeling about this stock market here. It's going down. If I buy into it, I'm going to make a fortune. Or I got a good feeling about this. I'm going to sell everything today and buy it all back again later. See, those simple decisions based on the overwhelm of data actually can cause quite a bit of trouble. And I was having this conversation with a client. If you sell all your stocks before the crash, and then the crash lasts less than a year, and you buy back all those stocks, you may not get the cost basis that you were expecting. You may have to buy it in a different account. You might have to buy it through a different... It becomes more complex than what can be covered in the news. Now, why do we believe that data mapping or making of dashboards or creation of metrics is a very easy process? Well, very often because in the news, we're constantly bombarded with simple measure counts. How many deaths? So a decision is made that the United States is not acting fast enough because the United States has more deaths than some tiny little country that has a smaller population. That is constantly in your ear. So as a professional, somebody who's interested in strategic relations, we want to understand the relationship between data and decision making so that we can use data to make better decisions. And that means understanding the two points that I'm covering here. One is the calculation. How was it calculated? Was the data accurate? Does the calculation have any meaning? And finally, the context of the calculation. It is always best to get that rough number up front. That's how our brains work. You want that rough calculation, that rough estimate. But then you've got to ask, where's the profit in this? How can I use this information? You've got to ask questions of the information. So having your customer lifetime value over a 12-month period is very useful. Then asking, well, what does this mean? Gives you an idea of how to use the information. So it means that if you get a new customer and every customer you get is worth $1,000, you've got to spend less than $1,000 to get that next customer. Because if all they're worth is $1,000 over the course of the year and you got to spend $2,000 to get them, you'd have been better off saving the $2,000 and finding a different customer. And if you can't, with the customers you have, get the dollars that you need, then you've got to look at if any of these customers, this is Pareto principle, if any of these customers are worth more than others. And what you'll probably find out, if your average customer lifetime value is $1,000, you've likely got customers that are worth $10,000 and customers that are worth negative $10,000. It's kind of a parity that you're looking for in order to dial in on the small number of customers that have the greatest value. Now, when we're talking about the coronavirus, how do you judge the performance of your government? Because they're doing a lot of different things. It's not like they're testing. You would want to look at then the composite statistics. Okay, so if we're looking at, I saw a great chart of this I'll try to link to. If you're looking at the number of deaths from day zero to current time, so when we first had the outbreak in Wuhan, what were the number of deaths? What was the trends of deaths as far as the count of deaths? And then we overlay that with day zero in Italy, day zero in Spain, day zero in the United States. And then as these charts are overlaid, and you may get more accurate information about people that died earlier or later, and you would overlay those charts and you would see, do they trend in the same direction? Now, if you're going to be anal retentive like I am, you do logarithmic regression and you determine if the trends are actually trends over top of each other and statistically accurate. But a simple measure of overlapping activities from day zero, out 30 days, out 60 days, will actually show you whether or not you're getting a performance improvement or a decline based on the actions taken. And this also helps you know that if all the states are having the same overlaid outbreak spread schedule and they're all doing different things, then that tells you what they're doing is ineffective. Let me roll this back to a practical example when it comes to business development. If you have an average customer lifetime value, Now you overlay all your customers from first transaction and you follow their follow-on transactions and you overlay that. What you're going to see is that the majority of those customers are going to follow the same trend. However, there'll be some that drop off and there'll be some that are above the trend. Those that are above the trend, meaning they bought product from you faster, doesn't mean they're more profitable. It just means you got more cash back faster. Well, that would be a segment to start looking at and asking questions about. Those who carry trend, those will be folks to look at if that trend is beneficial to the outcomes that your business wants. However, those who drop off trend, who may actually have bought and then stop buying, so instead of having a 12-month of transactions, they actually have maybe 3 months of transactions and then they never buy from you again. Well, that's another segment and group to look at. So I'm going to leave you three tips. First off, don't believe the numbers because simple counts are very often misleading and the conclusions you create from just the data itself isn't necessarily accurate. So you want to translate that data and make it more useful for decision making. And you translate that data by using some kind of metric, some kind of contextual measure, some comparative measures, and you're going to test that measurement. And then finally, you're going to set up models that identify segments inside the area of measure. So if you're measuring customers, what segments of customers do you have and what characteristics help you define those customers? And in the case of the COVID, for example, looking at age group demographics and other types of population density issues would help you know that if the virus spreads faster in a high population area versus a low population area, and then based on the speed or rate of transmission, you can identify whether you need quarantine in cities only or quarantines across the entire country. But again, the data is valuable, don't get me wrong, but it can be confusing if you don't have a systematic approach to develop useful measures, meaningful outcomes from the calculations, and then, of course, use that to identify segments of a larger population where then you can take specific and tailored actions. Very often, decisions on specific segments of a customer base, specific segments of a population, they tend to produce better results for the individuals who are on the receiving end of that problem solving or that solution that's being created. Now, again, very often we panic and we do everything and we think more action is better. And very often I'm even seen as lazy or not doing anything, but sometimes sitting back, taking in the numbers, making meaningful calculations, doing theses and hypotheses and testing them is very often more effective over time because, again, you want to make that data more useful for decision making. Not just pumping data to pump data, but actually being able to make accurate and valuable decisions. That's part of accurate thinking that we talk about here at Inside Strategic Relations. I'm Justin Hinton with Inside Strategic Relations, here to help you create and keep profitable customers and transform business relationships into profits. How do we do that? Well, we do that through clear and accurate thinking that develops for us both power and influence in a marketplace. Thanks for listening. You can ask your questions at www.insidestrategicrelations.com.